Okay, now we have look at the distal tubule. That is mainly DCT and the CD. Okay, so we have a look at the function of DCT and the CD. Starting with DCT. Now DCT is like a mini PCT. That means bulk of the remaining substances are going to be absorbed in which area? Transported DCT, right? Majority of remaining solutes are transported here. So that's why most of the things were reabsorbed in PCT. Now whatever is remaining, bulk of them will be reabsorbed in PCT after loop of Henle, obviously. So that's why majority of remaining solutes are transported here after loop of Henle in PCT, not the CD, but DCT is the area. Now what substances? First is, we'll discuss sodium and chloride reabsorption. Okay, sodium by sodium chloride symport or symporter. Now remember, all these transporters which are transporting ions in kidney, they have to maintain electrical balance, otherwise there will be electrical gradient maintained, which is not required. So that is why, to maintain the gradient, it absorbs 1 plus and 1 minus. So again you can write, it maintain electrical gradient. Remember, even loop of Henle, there was absorption of 2 plus sodium potassium and 2 minus chloride to balance the electrical charge. So maintain electrical gradient. So it's maintaining the electrical gradient. Okay. Now this importer can be blocked by what drugs? Thiazides. So blocked by thiazides, and again cause of loss of sodium, and sodium loss is coupled with others. So that's why loss of sodium and all major ions in urine. So loss of sodium and all major ions in urine. Except calcium, because of sodium calcium exchanger, except calcium. So they ask, what is the one major difference between the loop and the thiazides? Loop cause loss of all, they put everything in loop, but thiazide leave the calcium. So they leave the calcium. Okay, so decrease renal stones. Okay, whereas same way this importer can be defective also. So it is defective in Gitelman syndrome. That is why again Gitelman syndrome look like thiazide. So look like thiazide, loss of all except the calcium. So Bartter syndrome, all are lost. Gitelman, calcium is not lost. Okay. Now we see second function, the DCT2 is acid secretion. Number 2, acid secretion. But there is something which occur in PCT also. What is the special thing? Acidification start. Urine, acidification starts here. Some book give ascending loop also, but again ascending loop DCT are almost similar because they are now approaching each other. So urine acidification starts or begins here. Okay, which area? In the DCT. Okay, now let's start about the DCT. Okay, so what is happening in the case of the DCT, that is urine, as we begin. Okay, so first is mechanism is again electrical balance rule. If you want one H plus to be secreted, you must bring a H plus back. So sodium, hydrogen exchange. So sodium hydrogen is getting exchange in this particular case. Okay, so sodium hydrogen exchange. Okay, next is, so what happens? Sodium is reabsorbed and H plus is secreted. So you are gaining 1 plus and losing 1 plus. Okay, and write number 3, most important, potassium secretion by P cells. Okay, which are principal cells. Now these principal cells are mainly in which area? They are mainly in CD. Okay, they are in DCT also, but mainly CD. Okay, so what do the P cells do? There is a net sodium potassium exchange, net exchange of sodium with potassium. Okay, with potassium. So what is happening in this case? So what happens? There is a sodium reabsorption by ENAC. what thing? ENAC, that is very important, epithelial sodium channels, okay, very important. And who block them? They are blocked by amiloride, diuretics, amiloride diuretics, okay. And then there is also a potassium secretion by potassium channels. So, the net gain of sodium and a loss of potassium which is occurring here, okay. Now, what is these two transporters? They are both luminal border, luminal or apical border. Again same, luminal. So, these transporters are basically luminal border. Now, I will show this because a very important topic, because Alderstone all will require this to be taking place. So, we will discuss the mechanism of this transport, okay. So, we will discuss. So, we are going to see how this occurs. So, lumen, this is a lumen, this is sodium potassium pump, I will make on the basolateral membrane, okay. This is a basolateral, okay, basolateral, this is a luminal surface which has some brush border epithelium here also, little, this is a luminal border. So, luminal border, okay, and this is the urine here, and this is the cell, this is the blood vessels, peritubular, capillaries, etcetera, this is the blood vessels which contain the blood, okay. So, this is something we have discussed from the beginning, first topic itself, that all cells are surrounded by, yes, one side the cavity or chamber, other side may be the blood vessels. So, now first thing is, sodium potassium pump is pumping 3 sodium out, that is why sodium is very high and this will increase in ECF. So, that is why sodium is very high in ECF etcetera, because constantly pumped out of the cell by sodium potassium pumps, clear, and that is why you do not need anything else to bring the sodium, whatever sodium is in urine, how it came, via filtration. So, that is why filtered sodium when it come to the tubules is already very high in the urine, but less in the cell. Why there is less sodium in the cell? Because of constant pumping of pump making what sodium? Increase sodium outside and low sodium inside. So, that is why the moment you open a channel here, it cause what? The sodium to enter, this epithelial sodium channel, and now the sodium can easily enter the cell. So, what is the reason for sodium coming in? Is basically not the epithelial channel, is basically sodium potassium pump, which is maintaining high sodium outside, low in the cell, allowing sodium to be reabsorbed, okay. By same logic, what does it also do? It is going to take the potassium, it is going to take the potassium and make the potassium enter the interstitium. Why? Because constantly it is pumping 2 potassium in. So, potassium level will be decreased in the blood, in the ECF. Why? Because they are constantly pumped into the cell. So, there is so much potassium in the cell, so high potassium, the moment you open a transporter or the channel, what happened? The sodium came in, the potassium will move out. This is the potassium channel, okay. And now the potassium will just simply escape out into the urine. So, in simple language, what is driving the whole transport process? It is sodium potassium pump. How? See this, okay. So, this pump is taking first the sodium in the cell, then into the blood. So, sodium is shifting from urine to the blood via 2 membranes, apical and basolateral. And on the other hand, the potassium is going in the reverse direction. How? So, see, it is going first to the cell, then to the lumen. So, that is why, what is the driving force for this transport? It is sodium potassium pump on basolateral membrane, okay. So, now if this pump is triggered, this whole transport process is enhanced multiple times. So, let us see what happens. Aldosterone, and one more thing I just forgot to write, also there is a acid secretion occurring. So, I will just show it, also it causes acid secretion. So, also we do a H plus secretion. So again, what is the energy coming from? The sodium potassium pump. So that's why you throw potassium and the H plus and you bring sodium into the blood. So let's start now. So what the aldosterone do? So aldosterone stimulate P cells, by increasing sodium potassium ATPase pump at basolateral membrane, okay. And what is the result? And that causes two changes. One is it causes increase sodium reabsorption, but at the cost of what? Potassium and H plus secretion, and increase potassium and H plus secretion. So, in simple language, it bring plus ion in which plus? Sodium in 3 plus, let us say, and throwing potassium and H plus out. So, that is why it increase the sodium level, increase blood sodium and decrease what? And decrease blood potassium and H plus. So, that is one line summary of aldosterone increasing what? Increasing, yes, the sodium by losing potassium and H plus ions in urine, okay. Clear? Now, the point here is, so if aldosterone is more, that is a change. So, that is why what increase aldosterone? So, that is why increase aldosterone by three changes. One is increase, decrease serum sodium, increase serum potassium and angiotensin II, that is a RAS system. Why? Because all these conditions are interlinked. You know, sodium is gained, potassium is lost. So, a lower sodium trigger aldosterone to correct the aldosterone back to normal, sodium back to normal by aldosterone, and also high potassium cause aldosterone to remove the potassium and keep it normal. So, this is the simple summary. So, if sodium level are high, so aldosterone decrease. If low, aldosterone increase in this case. Okay. Now, see the next important thing. Okay. There is a net, you can say, competition between potassium and H plus for secretion. So, that is why hyperkalemia will cause, yes, less acid secretion, rather more potassium secretion and vice versa. That is why hyperkalemia is related to acidosis and vice versa. So, right, hyperkalemia cause increased potassium secretion and less H plus secretion and vice versa. So, that is why what happens? Hyperkalemia, kidney will throw more potassium with exchange with sodium. So, H plus is secreted less, causing acidosis. Also, there is shift of H plus from cell into the ECF, causing again acidosis. So, that is why hyperkalemia is associated, or rather causing acidosis, and vice versa, MCQ. Okay. So, that is why hyperkalemia can cause less acid secretion, resulting in increased H plus in blood, causing acidosis. Okay. Next, if aldosterone decrease or increase, what are the obvious effect of that? So, let us see effects of increased aldosterone. Okay. So, we will see the effects of increased aldosterone. First is increased aldosterone is seen in Cohn's syndrome, and that cause a classical feature of hypernatremia because of high sodium reabsorption, that cause osmosis and increased blood volume, hypervolemia. Then also it causes what? Yes, hypertension because of high volume, you know, increased stroke volume, cardiac output, BP, hypervolemia, and sorry, hypertension. Then there is more potassium secretion causing hypokalemia, okay, and also causes what thing? Yes, it causes what? Metabolic alkalosis because of more acid secretion. So, these are the features of Cohn's, okay. And one more thing, hypokalemia cause hyperpolarization, and that cause, you know, because more potassium will shift outside because of hypokalemia, which I discuss in nerve muscle physiology, that cause hyperpolarization and spastic paralysis of the muscles. Sorry. It causes flaccid paralysis because of less excitation. So, you get flaccid paralysis. So, these are the changes which we see in case of Cone's syndrome. Okay. So, it causes hyperpolarization and flaccid paralysis, okay, muscle wasting occur. Okay. Now, let us reverse it and see which condition. Let us say there is a increase ultrasound over, now decrease. What is the name of the disease? Addison's disease. Addison's disease. Now, everything is reversed. There is hyponatremia, hypovolemia, hypotension, okay, hypotension. Then there is hyperkalemia and metabolic acidosis. Metabolic acidosis, and that causes a depolarization because of what? Yes, high potassium, because potassium is not secreted, that causes depolarization, can cause arrhythmias. Also, if you remember ST elevation, ST segment elevation and tall T waves, ECG changes. Okay. So, these are ECG changes. Okay. So, ST elevation because of what? Again, there is a hyperkalemia just like in MI. So, ST elevation, tall T wave, also depolarization, but this time it will cause spastic paralysis because the muscles are too excited. So, they go into contractions called as spastic paralysis. Okay. So, that is the case. Now, this metabolic acidosis due to decreased aldosterone is RTA4. So, now we have done the RT also. RTA1 was distal tubular acidosis, RT2 is which one? Proximal tubular. RTA4 is aldosterone deficiency or hormonal disorder where the kidney cannot secrete acid because of aldosterone or maybe renin lack causing the decreased aldosterone activity. Okay, RTA4. RT3 is mix, 1 and 2 mixture. This is RT3 or childhood RT. Okay. Now, we see the collecting duct CD. Okay. So, first is CD is very, very important. Why? I told you it is the last side of information, very important. All major hormones act here. So, start with CD. So, first is CD has two types of cells. First are P cells and second are I cells. So, P cells and the I cells. Okay. Now, they are in DCT also, as I discussed. They are in DCT also. So, they are where? In the DCT also. They are present in DCT also, but mainly if they ask an exam, CD. Let us discuss I cell. I cells are basically alpha intercalated cells. Alpha intercalated cells, what they do? They do acid secretion by H plus pump. So, acid secretion by the H plus pump. Why? Because by the time the urine reach the distal tubule is already acidic, and to throw more acid you have to go along or against the gradient, requiring a pump. That is why this pump will create what? It will create, yes, minimum urine pH. Remember 4.5 limiting pH, minimum urine pH, distal tubule, and maximum acidification. So, it causes limiting pH and maximum acidification of urine. Both occur in CD, what cells? I cells. Okay. Now, if I cells are damaged, you fail to acidify and you also, yes, fail to secrete the acid causing RTA. So, I cell lesion cause RTA1. So, which I discussed already, what is RTA1 and 2? It is a distal tubular acidosis where kidney fail to secrete acid and also acidify the urine. So, that is why urine pH will be, yes, becoming high because you lost the ability to acidify. Okay. Now, we see other properties of CD. So, right. CD is water impermeable without ADH. So, what is very, very important here? ADH is one of the most important things here because it make it water permeable. Without ADH, it is not water permeable. So, what are the function ADH will do or perform here? First is ADH help CD reabsorb water and urea. The most important thing here is the urea. How? Via basically UT, urea transporter. It's multiple type, 1, 2, 3. So urea transporter. Okay. Now as you increase the urea transporter, urea is reabsorbed, and where it goes? It goes to medulla, and this will now make medulla hypertonic. That is help in counter current system. So which hormone and which area also help? Not just loop of Henle and the vasa recta, but also ADH and urea help in counter current system. And some books say urea cause more than 30-40% of the osmolarity. So it's very very important system. So how urea enter medulla? Mainly by the action of ADH in the collecting ducts. Okay. Next question. So how does ADH act? So as we all know, ADH is polypeptide. Is a polypeptide. So it act through what? GPCR. So act by GPCR. That is cell surface G protein coupled receptors. Two types. Okay. Two types of GPCR, two types of receptors. Okay. So there are two G protein coupled receptors. One is V1, that is vasopressin 1, and V2, vasopressin 2. Now, what do the V1 and V2 do? So I told you, GPCR act through cyclic AMP, GMP, or IP3DAG. Here, it will use both. V1 increase IP3DAG. That increase calcium and cause smooth muscle contraction. That is vasoconstriction. Of afferent and efferent arteriole. Thereby it can control renal blood flow and GFR. Okay. Whereas V2 increase cyclic AMP, increase aquaporin 2, and that increase H2O reabsorption. Also it help in UT also, urea transporter. So help in aquaporin and UT transporter. So what is the one for water reabsorption? V2. So remember like this. Okay. So easy way to remember is 2, 2, 2. See, V2, aquaporin 2, H2, 2, 2, 2, all 2s are together, and drink the water, it drink P, so it is P cell. So V2 are drinking the water, P cells. So P cell contain the V2 receptor, okay, cyclic AMP. Okay. Ask in again recent exam. Okay. Now comes the question, some author divide the V1 into multiple types, V1A and V1B. V1A is same, vasoconstrictor. But V1B increase ACTH secretion. So that is why V1B increase, and some books say do not use V1B, they rather use V3. So as per some book, V3 is subtract hormone, some say it is a subtype of V1 which increase the ACTH and cause the increase in ACTH stress response. Okay. Clear?